So I'm John Eckman. I'm talking today about why the blank isn't WordPress CMS, and this is a talk that I've been actually having in the hallways at WordCamps and having at conferences with attendees over the last like 2 years. So it's the first time that it's come together as an actual structured presentation, but it's, you know, I'll be honest up front, it's a little bit inside baseball. It's a little bit too focused on the WordPress community, and I'd like it to be a little more client-focused, but I think it helps kind of define a conversation that's critical, that in other ways we're not having, right? So I'm trying deliberately to foreground a certain conversation. So a bunch of links here. I'm the managing director for the Boston office of a company called iSite Design. We also have an office up in Portland, Oregon. We are a digital agency focused on brands who want to differentiate out of customer experience, which is a nice way of saying we create digital presences. I also am a myth buster and blogger for the CMS Myth, which is a blog that addresses the content management industry and tries to advocate on behalf of users and companies to counteract some of the myths that vendors and platforms and developers offer. So I think that positions me interestingly for this conversation. Open parenthesis is my personal blog. I have a bunch of stuff up at GitHub, including a bunch of WordPress plugins, the favorite of which I just actually launched on Friday, which is Hello Dolly, D-A-L-A-I. It takes Hello Dolly and replaces the lyrics with Dalai Lama quotes. That's my Twitter handle. So over the last, you know, 12 years, I've been working in this industry. So I've been working in the industry for the last 12, 15 years, very expensive content management platforms. I've done big, expensive proprietary implementations, Vignette, Interwoven, Documentum. I've done sort of mid-market, .NET, Ektron, Sitecore. I'm in the midst of actually project managing a large Sitecore implementation right now. Do a lot of work in the Drupal community and in the WordPress community. In fact, I was supposed to be volunteering today over at Design for Drupal, which is happening over at the Status Center, but couldn't quite get them all in the same weekend. And so I've spent a lot of time in the content management world with kind of different parts of this experience. And so my colleague Jeff Cram, who I work with at iSite, posted this blog post back on March of 2010, in which he engaged in a conversation that was going on Twitter with Dirk Shaw, who's an SVP at Ogilvy and a frequent writer on content management issues. She said, "I'm sorry, but WordPress hardly counts as CMS." Right? And Jeff weighed in and said, "I think WordPress is certainly CMS in the sense that plenty of sites run on it." Irina weighed in. Irina Gosebo is one of the analysts of the Real Story Group, so this is a person whose career and profession is oriented toward talking to enterprises about how to evaluate content management platforms. And then Scott Lieber, who at the time I believe was still at Domain, now runs a company called Digital Clarity Group. Again, these are analysts in the industry who are talking to enterprises and nonprofits and smaller organizations about how to adapt CMS, how to do CMS projects, how to do CMS selection, how to manage their content. And they're saying, you know, WordPress is not a CMS. WordPress isn't a content management system at all. It doesn't even deserve a label. So a year later, it's May 2012, I was speaking at a conference called CMS Expo in Chicago, and I noticed that WordPress was once again absent, right, from the conversation. It was not, did not count as a content management system to the folks at the conference. So Phil Sturgeon, who's one of the folks behind Pyro CMS and other content management systems, was quoting from a keynote. So Liz Strauss gives a keynote at the conference and says during her conference, she's using Matt Mullenweg as an example and the automatic company as an example of a successful community-led project. And she says, "I understand where WordPress fits in the spectrum of content management systems." And Phil picked up on this and said, "Well, that's a polite way to put it or a clever way to put it," by what she really meant at the bottom. Other people weighed in. If we don't establish now that blog software isn't a CMS, of course that's meant to be a dig at WordPress, we're going to be wasting 3 days. Finally, Luis Hernandez comes right up and says, "I'm not sick of WordPress bashing. You are not a CMS." Okay? And David Scarhoon, who's a content strategist, finally weighed in and said, "It's easy to bash the elephant not in the room." Right? So it's really easy to sort of be hating on WordPress when they're not even there to defend themselves. So I did tweet several times. And the links that are in this presentation actually point to the blog post that has all the tweets, and then I'll post these slides after the talk, so you don't need to feel like you need to try to scramble to write any URLs down. So what does all this mean? What does it matter if WordPress is or isn't a content management system? And that's why I said that to some extent this is a little bit inside baseball, but it matters a lot to WordPress. It matters a lot to people who make their living designing and developing on WordPress, and it matters a lot to you if you have to try to sell WordPress inside your company as a viable platform or something like that, right? So even though it's kind of artificial in the sense that it's about labels and really we should be focused on what we're accomplishing, I think it's ultimately important. And so content management system fundamentally is a system for managing content, a set of tools and technologies that let you gather content, store it, archive it, let people work together on it, etc. So in what sense then would one say that WordPress is not a CMS? In the sense that it's not a system? In the sense that it doesn't manage? Or in the sense that what you put in it isn't content? Right? I'm going to sort of reverse to try to figure out which one of those three would actually lead you to that belief. But I see three major reasons. And so the first of those major reasons is just haters gonna hate. What I mean by that is when you're, regardless of your political position, when Mitt Romney becomes the leader in the Republican primary, he becomes the guy with the target on his back, he becomes the person everybody goes after. When the state of the word comes out and we hear that 14.7% of the top million websites are on WordPress and 22 out of 100 new domains are WordPress domains, everybody suddenly wants to say WordPress isn't a content management system, right? To which I would say, haters gonna hate it, right? I mean, that's the problem. Actually, like that one better, but I couldn't decide this morning which one. So reason number one is just, you know, it's the most popular platform, therefore it gets attacked, right? That's a kind of natural tendency in competitive environments. But the second is that it's just that people would say WordPress is just a blog platform, right? So if you look at kind of these conversations in which people are saying WordPress isn't a CMS, and you ask a couple of follow-up questions, what they mean isn't it's not a system for managing content. They mean it's only a blog, and that's one very particular kind of CMS, and it doesn't really qualify for the general way, right? It's kind of like, you know, the two-seater electric smart car. Maybe a car, but it doesn't really count with all the other, you know, American muscle cars or whatever. And I think the interesting question is sort of, as we think about why people get that impression, I think unfortunately this is one of those moments where we've met the enemy and it's us. We keep telling them that that's what WordPress is. And I know it's a little tricky to use the we here because there are lots of different we's in the WordPress community. But we'll start with WordPress.com, right? What does WordPress.com tell people about WordPress? It's a better way to blog. And when you think about WordPress.com's position as one of the most heavily trafficked sites on the web, that means something, right? Now, I know most of those people aren't coming to this page, they're going to somebody's blog, but the fact that that's kind of the core definition behind the phrase WordPress, and it's what most people know WordPress as, if they're not in the insight conversation, is important. You go to the About Us, WordPress.com is brought to you by the same folks who work on the open source blogging software available at WordPress.org. Right? Now, if I'm an SEO consultant and I'm working with a company to rebrand their products, and if that product were WordPress as a content management system, I would say, here are your two fundamental problems, right? You yourself are still describing this platform as a blogging platform, and that's what the world is learning. That's what the web is learning. That's what all these links mean. That's what this traffic means. Go to WordPress.com, or I mean .org, sorry, and you get WordPress's web software you can use to create a beautiful website or blog. So at least we've gone off blog as the first, but it's still a website, right? Which has kind of a static, not very compelling sound to it. It's not a dynamic web application. It's not a digital presence. It's not a content management system. It's something you use to build a beautiful website or blog. That could be Dreamweaver, right? I mean, there's nothing about sort of the scope and flexibility and power yet. WordPress.com VIP, where you would expect to start to get, and this is one of the slides where I was worried about contrast. It's a screenshot from VIP, so it's their low contrast online. But this is where you would expect to get some of the enterprise conversation going, and it's still basically, because we run WordPress.com, which is so high traffic, we must be really good at high traffic websites, therefore we understand your enterprise problems. There's not a whole lot that gets more in depth about sort of content management. Finally, at the bottom of that page, three screens down, you find out that WordPress is a world-class content management system. That's sort of the first place that you start to see the content management language come out. And you can apply to become a WordPress.com VIP. I just think that's killer. When you think about enterprises who are used to being courted by IBM and Oracle and Stellant and sort of kind of vignette and interwoven, and sending a CIO from one of those companies to WordPress.com and saying, you can apply to be a VIP, and maybe they'll get back. Right? It has this sort of velvet rope feeling that I think is difficult for the enterprise to understand. So a brief kind of thought experiment. What would have happened if back in 2003, I guess 2003 is when the first public release comes out, maybe this starts a little earlier, when Matt starts working on what becomes WordPress, if he chosen a different name for the software than what became WordPress.com in 2005, right? So we're now 7 years past the founding of .com, or the first public availability in 2005. And we still are at a position where regularly people confuse or misunderstand or don't get that WordPress.com and WordPress.org are not identical, right? I still get lots of questions who call WordPress.com the free version and WordPress.org the paid version, which to me is perverse because .org is pretty free and open source software, but makes sense if you think about it from an outsider's point of view in the sense that I don't pay money when I go to WordPress.com, but when I set something up with software I downloaded from WordPress.org, I'm probably paying the hosting provider. So to them, it feels like this is the paid version, right? It's all inverted and wrong. And this notion that the thing that drives WordPress.com, one of the top 10 web properties of the world, is also what's available over here at WordPress.org, casts that software in a certain light. That light is a blog platform, a high power, high scale blog platform, but nevertheless a blogging platform. So then we turn around to people and say, why do you keep saying WordPress is a blog? Well, because we keep telling them that, right? This is our issue as much as theirs. So counterexample, as I said, I spent a lot of time in the Drupal community. I'm using a bunch of Drupal examples here. This isn't to say that Drupal is a better platform than WordPress. I don't believe that, and I wouldn't make that argument at a WordCamp even if I did. It's to say that they're fundamentally different in their histories and in their origins in ways that are instructive. In some ways, they're incredibly similar. Open source, popular, LAMP, staff-based content management applications. In a lot of ways, Matt and Dries, the two co-founders, have a lot of similarities. And yet, they've taken drastically different paths to get to where they are today. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that. But the first thing that we notice is that when you go to Drupal.org, Drupal is an open source content management platform. Right? That's the tag that the SEO people are after. That's the thing that tells the world this is what we do. And only much later did we get Drupal Gardens, which was the hosted equivalent to WordPress.com, right? This is where you can get a Drupal site free in the same way that WordPress.com is free in a hosted environment, but it comes much later. It has a different name. It still says powered by the Drupal platform, but it's separate. It doesn't have this identity confusion. Nobody mistakes Drupal Gardens for Drupal. Even outsiders don't really mistake that this is the same thing. They understand that it's a version that's being presented to them in a very specific way. Now, some of that's sort of artifacts of timing rather than necessary strategy, but we'll talk about what that means. So I want to talk about edge cases, right? So one of the sort of questions that's at stake here, I said there were three reasons why people don't think WordPress is a CMS. One is because they're haters. Two is because we keep telling them it's a blog platform. The third is because there are some cases that we're weak on when it comes to the content management industry, right? When you think about the full suite of things that a content management framework or content management system might do, there are some we do better than others. This is true for every student, right? This is Emily Finch. She's a mother with six children in Portland who doesn't own a car and does everything by bike. Can you use a bicycle to be a stay-at-home mom with six children? Of course you can. Most people buy an SUV, right? She is an edge case. She's living an interesting, compelling life. I'm sure her kids are brilliant. I'm sure she's a wonderful person. But she's an edge case, which is, I'm sure, revealing some interesting things about the city of Portland and their bicycle friendliness, right? I'm sure there are cases where she feels like it's not the ideal platform. We need to think about how much content management as a set of needs is an edge case for the WordPress community, and how much is it at the core. So if the core of our community remains blogging, notice I said if, but I don't know if that's true. I assume that that's probably the likely case. If the core of our community is individuals setting up blogs, small businesses setting up simple websites, What does that say about large enterprises who might be considering WordPress for running not just their blog, but their corporate site, for actually using it as a core content management platform? Do they become, in the process, edge cases? So a couple of the things that I think WordPress struggles with as, I'll call them, edge cases. And Jake Bolt did a presentation yesterday in which he went through some similar lists, and we have mostly overlap, but we have a couple of places where we're different. I want to be clear to the engineers and developers in the room. I'm not saying WordPress can't do any of these things. Just like I'm saying a bike can't be used to manage a six-person, a six-child family. I'm saying that sometimes when one is using WordPress to do some of these things, it feels a bit like you're swimming upstream, or you're working in an opposite brain from the core of the community, or you're an edge case, right? Multilingual. What I mean by multilingual isn't just the capability to have blogs in different languages, right? It's to understand enterprise requirements around automated translation, around fallback if a different language equivalent is not available, around subtitling in different languages, around complex content types that have different multilingual requirements, around legal approval that's different in different languages and because of the different regulations in different countries. There's much more to multilingual and internationalization than just, can I get a .pot file for this plugin and put it in translation, right? Or can we handle right-to-left languages? We've got the sort of publishing simple side of it solved, but the managing a complex multinational part, we're still struggling with. Publish for remote servers. What if, so the sort of default assumption in the WordPress world is that your authoring and your publication are on the same machine, right? You log into WordPress and you write posts that you hit publish and they're published, because WordPress is running on that server. In a lot of the enterprise CMS world, those are two separate applications. There's an authoring set of code, and publishing is unidirectional and goes into some kind of site that knows how to render, but doesn't have the authoring code in it. A sort of extreme example of the kinds of situations that I'm talking about is Al Jazeera, which runs servers in multiple different countries by their bylaw, they're required to. And they have authors in each of those places, all of whom need to be able to push to servers in other locations. And so they have a very complicated system with global unique IDs on content that lets all of that be synchronized in a kind of mesh many-to-many fashion. When I think about trying to do that in WordPress, I get shivers. Not to say it couldn't be possible, but it would be a lot of effort to get to that point. Extended fine-grained user permissions. Of course, there are ways to do this, but working with Procter & Gamble on an intranet, for example, they wanted to do a small beta rollout, and I was all excited about that until they said that's 50,000 employees. To me, that's not small. When you get to large numbers of users that need to be fit in lots of different roles, it can get very complicated and ungainly to manage through the WordPress APIs and actions. Content targeting and dynamic personalization. This is something that the site boards of the world are making a lot of marketing noise about today and have some very compelling and interesting technology in. Which is to say, how do I know based on an anonymous user's clickstream over time what they might be interested in so that I can serve them more of that? And there's some plugins that start to do some of this in the WordPress community, but I don't feel like we've gotten as close to core as we need to really understand what dynamic personalization looks like with users who aren't registered as users, right? But they're anonymous users that we've seen over time over and over again. We tend to sort of put anonymous users in one big giant bucket, cache the hell out of what they're going to see, and not make any of it dynamic. Custom applications with high user interaction, that's related to user management. Complex workflow, yes, edit flow is fantastic and there's some good things, but if you think about complex workflow from the point of view of editions or content bundles, what if I have five new products that are coming out and there are associated press releases and blog posts about them and videos about them? I want to stage it all, I want to preview it all, and then I want it all to go live on the same day. Right? It's a complex set of requirements to send a bundle of objects through workflow. Custom post types gets here, but it's complicated. And then digital asset management scale. WordPress has great strength when it comes to using media in blogs, right? And using media in what I would call simple CMSs, pages. When you start to get to, I have 50,000 images and I need to manage their rights because some of them I only have right to use in print, some of them I only have a right to use in the US, some of them I only have a right to use in Europe. WordPress is not strong in that, right? So, I said we talked a little bit about Drupal and WordPress. I want to talk about Threes and Matt. So those of you who don't know in the room, I suspect you mostly do, that's Threes Picard on the left, who's the founder of the Drupal project. And that's Matt's hair circa 2009. I don't know if he's changed his hair recently, but that's the picture that I have. This is them sharing the stage together at the Schiphol conference in Amsterdam. There's a fantastic video. Again, the link is in the presentation, or if you just Google Matt Mullenweg and Dries Pittard on stage, you'll find it. It's about an hour long. Great video of them talking about their respective sort of attitudes and philosophies behind their projects and what makes them different. Really enlightening and interesting. We tried to get the two of them on stage at WordCamp, but so far we haven't been able to do it, even though Dries lives in Boston. So get on personalities, right? I'm a big believer that 5 years, 8 years, 10 years, 12 years into a project, these projects still bear a remarkable imprint of the people who founded them, right? It's not to say that Dries and Matt are their respective projects. They've both had thousands of contributors. They've both had lots of different people involved. But there's still definitely a sort of strong thumbprint, or whatever you want to call it, from each of them on the projects that they work on. So Dries has a PhD, a master's degree, and an undergraduate degree all in computer science. Right? He's an engineer. Drupal starts as a dorm room project to let all the people who live in the house with them leave each other messages on a kind of computer bulletin board. Right? Very early, very hackerish, becomes very little design, very focused on APIs and getting the technology right, and very little focused on what the user experience is like, as engineers are wont to do, and I say this as an engineer myself. Acquia doesn't get founded until 2008. When it does, it comes out as a very big enterprise company focused on supporting Drupal, being to Drupal what Red Hat was to Linux. Right? So it comes from kind of that mindset. His thesis is on profiling techniques for performance analysis and optimization of Java applications. Right? This is hardcore computer science PhD person. Matt, on the other hand, studies poli-sci at the University of Houston, leaves before graduating to join CNET to be part of the web content revolution. Right? Fundamentally different path. Nothing wrong with either of them. This is not a critique of Matt and his education. Both are brilliant entrepreneurs who have founded successful companies and done great open source projects, and I have tremendous respect for them both, but they're just very different. Starts WordPress in 03, automatic and WordPress.com come out in 2005. Interestingly, Matt has a profile as a user on Drupal.org and lists as one of his interests, simplicity. So it goes into the Drupal community in 2005, it's already 5 years old. He's interested in the software, but puts as his interest simplicity, which I can only take as a little bit of a jab at Drupal's complexity, right? You can think about this when you think about features of their various products. What's Matt excited about in WordPress? Distraction-free writing, aka Zen mode. Naming releases after jazz musicians. What's Dries excited about in Drupal? The semantic web and RDF and APIs, right? Now that's not entirely fair. The Drupal community is also focused in on design. There is a Drupal design camp going on in Boston right now. They're very focused on how to make usability better at Drupal. Matt obviously is also a very smart developer, and there are great core devs. There's a huge developer community at WordCamp in Boston of smart engineers. So, you know, I gotta be careful about my grand generalizations here, but there is still something to it. You look at Acquia versus Automatic. Both PC funded, but Acquia comes out of the gate, you know, all barrels blazing, we are going to be the enterprise support for Drupal, right? As opposed to Automatic, which sort of grows more slowly over time. Maybe they're speeding up now, if I look at the hiring pattern, but certainly still takes a much longer path to get there. The focus line on the Automatic website, we're passionate about making the web a better place. The focus line on the Acquia website, your enterprise guide to Drupal. Got to be more different in terms of their intent. So what does all this suggest about them as platforms? And I know I'm drawing some pretty broad brush comparisons here, but I think they'll probably resonate with most of your experience, and they are the reputation these products carry. I wouldn't say entirely deserved, but I also wouldn't say that they're wildly off-base in some sense, right? There's a core essence of truth in these differentiations. Drupal has an engineering culture, deep learning curve, but very powerful once learned. The WordPress community has much more a design and content culture, right? It has much more a focus on fundamentals and simplicity design. One interesting thing to do is look at bytart.net and put it up against ma.tt, right? Their personal logs, and to see how we're after their whole approaches. Think about Jane and the focus on user experience in the WordPress community, the focus on and attention to what changes in the admin interface mean for end users who are writing content. That has been a very strong focus in the WordPress community from the beginning. It's a focus that Drupal is now picking up, but it's one that was less there in the beginning. So this is an interesting tweet exchange that happened around the time that Drupal 7 came out, around the time that WordPress 3 came out, actually. And that's Dries retreating, Chicks, who's a developer in the Drupal community. WordPress is now approximately where Drupal was around Drupal 5, which is to say 5 years ago, right? So great, WordPress community, now you have custom post types, now you're getting interesting, you're back where you were 5 years ago. Somebody in the WordPress community responded, and hopefully Drupal 7 will be where WordPress was around 5 years ago in terms of its user experience. Right? And Dries said, fair enough, you're right, right? There's some truth in that criticism. So we've got a WordPress that's easy to use, flexible, beautiful, works well for a broad platform and some simple content management needs. And we've got a Drupal that's complex, difficult to understand, high learning curve, but incredibly powerful. So the question is, given those two opposing positions, and the fact that these are the two most powerful or most popular open source content management platforms today by a long margin, what, if anything, should we do about the state of WordPress as a content management system? Is this a problem? Is it something we want to solve? And again, I'm very conscious of the sort of we is problematic here because there are lots of different parts of the WordPress community. This is a thing that was very popular when this first came out. This is the learning curve for popular CMSs. Drupal is in the black. WordPress is one of the green ones, I think. Yeah, it's the green one. And this comes out of folks in the Drupal community, right? I mean, this is kind of self-deprecating recognition that the learning curve is a little too difficult. It's actually ripped off from a similar draft that was for MMRPGs, but then they replaced the axes without changing any of the data. But, you know, do we want to risk that complexity? Do we want to risk losing our simplicity in order to achieve those goals? And so one of the things that this discussion always makes me think of is this quote from Ed Begley in Build the Electric Car. And he basically says, it's right, people are right. The electric vehicle isn't for everybody. Given the limited range, it can only meet the needs of 90% of the global population. Which is a kind of way of saying, you're right, we aren't going to solve everybody's problems, but you know what? 90% of the world's global population is pretty damn good, right? We can get 22 out of every 100 new domains running WordPress without making it a more complicated system. What are we going to get by adding more complicated enterprise CMS features, right? So the question ultimately comes down to, should we be focused on those things? And if so, how would we do so? And so one of the questions or conversations that I've been having with people is sort of, should there be a fourth of WordPress that focuses on CMS use cases? And I don't say this in the sort of, some people in the open source community hear fork and they think, oh, you know, tension, fighting, I'm going to take my ball and go home, I don't want to talk to them anymore. I don't mean a hostile fork. I mean a focus, right? Should there be a downstream, an application, a distribution, whatever we want to call it? Should there be a sub-community within the WordPress community that focuses on answering this need, that draws upon core, contributes to core where appropriate, and leverages some of the same strengths, but also creates a package that's different? I can tell you from personal experience, working with a CIO or a VP of IT at a large company and telling them we're going to use WordPress as a CMS, and the first thing they do is they go install it. And they say, wait a minute, I got a blog, right? Because by default, you get a blog. You get a hello world. You get, here's your first comment. Here's your first post. You have to go turn that off and say, I want a static homepage, right? Drupal comes at it from just the opposite position. You turn it on, you got nothing, right? You got to figure it out. You got to create some content then. You got to figure out how to make it do something. And their answer has been distributions, which are sort of packaged versions of Drupal that target specific markets. Now, I don't know that that's exactly the right position for us. It creates its own kind of complexity because then people get confused about which distribution is which and which one they're on, and you know, it can cause its own kind of set of confusion. But I wonder if we're reaching the point in our maturity where a core team that only focuses on one group isn't able to serve both ends of that spectrum, right? We believe in being a big tech community, we believe in trying to keep our focus broad, but I wonder if we're starting to sort of feel that stretch at the edges and reach the point where some focus time by certain individuals would be beneficial. Things to keep in mind as we do that, we don't want to lose our existing advantages. I don't know if the projector contrast can show you that, but there's an easy button right in the background. We don't want, in the process of solving certain edge cases in WordPress, selling into the enterprise, selling bigger content management oriented engagements, using WordPress as a web application framework. There's a great presentation about that yesterday from Oshkos. As we start to think about these more complicated uses, our goal should be, how can we accomplish those without losing the advantages we have, without sacrificing ease of use, without sacrificing this focus on the content editor and the content user, right? How do we differentiate between WordPress.org and WordPress.com better while still benefiting from the fact that WordPress.com is a massive online real-time testing library for anything that goes into WordPress? That is a huge benefit that very few other platforms have anything remotely like it. So we don't want to lose that at the same time as we think about serving other needs. I also think this is a really great time for leveraging what WordPress is good at. So as I look at the content management community, there are a couple of things that are happening that make WordPress as a CMS very timely. And I don't mean timely in the sense of this week. I mean, you know, over this 12 months or this 18 months, the kind of shifts at the multi-year level that are happening. One is a shift in buying power from IT to business owner. So for the longest time, content management systems essentially ignored their content users because they knew that the guy signing the check, it was usually a guy, was in IT. Right? So the person who actually bought the software didn't have to use it, and the people who were frustrated and hated using the software didn't have enough say in buying it. We're increasingly not seeing that happen. We're increasingly seeing people at the table who own the content, content strategists, marketing technologists, VPs of technology who have a smart business background, VPs of e-business, right? People who really understand what the business is trying to accomplish now have power. Renewed interest in and focus on content strategy. For the longest time, I used to tell everybody that, you know, content in the CMS is treated as the way that students are treated at a university, which is to say, this would be a great place to work for all those students, which my faculty is telling me. We work in a content management industry, and yet we pay shockingly little attention often to content, right? And increasingly, content strategists have been reminding us that this is a problem. And I now see large-scale content management platform projects that begin with a focus on content strategy even before a platform is selected, which is the right way to do it, but not something you experienced 5 years ago, right? Typically, the content strategist was brought in after all the development was done and said, here, use this. We're also seeing focused small initiatives rather than large enterprise rollouts. So one of the sort of challenges that I didn't mention earlier from a culture perspective is the release cycle for WordPress. So from a marketing and branding perspective, the fact that Drupal can say, here's Drupal 7.x, and that's fundamentally and radically different than Drupal 6.x. Whereas in the WordPress community, we sort of say, well, you know, the next dot release is coming out in 3 or 4 months, and it'll have some new features, but there isn't this, like, ethical change. You can't sort of say, oh, you're thinking, you know, you run into somebody who says, oh, WordPress is just a blog platform. And you have to sort of say, well, no, you know, the merge of multi-site happened in 2.9, and then custom post types came in 3.0, and then we got custom post types archives came out in 3.1.4, and then, you know, you have to sort of, in your head, remember all these iterative releases, which are great from a project management point of view, but can be frustrating from a marketing point of view. Well, the reality is enterprises are starting to look more like WordPress faster than WordPress is starting to look more like enterprise software, right? So the release cycle that they're after is actually getting more like ours. So that's a good thing. Focus on design, usability, and content impact. In a lot of ways, the content management industry is shifting from one in which the focus of the CMS was around gathering and managing assets, like bits and bytes, right? The content management system is a big set of buckets into which we pour these content bits, and shifting more in the direction of sort of what's the impact that content has on the user. More focus on customer engagement, more focus on dynamic delivery, more focus on social, more focus on user-contributed content. All more focus on responsive design, right? Responsive design is all about how is the user consuming this. And all of those things are in WordPress's favor, or in favor of WordPress as a CMS. So closing thoughts, and then I've got some time for questions. So in case it wasn't clear, yes, I believe WordPress certainly can be used as a CMS. The ultimate question is, do these become edge cases, and folks like Jake and Tenup who are doing enterprise CMS installations on WordPress are pioneers and kind of edge cases, and they're fighting a good fight, but they're never going to become part of the sort of core functionality. Or do they become more a part of core over time, and WordPress starts to take on ownership of more of these features? In trying to grow WordPress as a CMS, which I do actually think is valuable, a couple of things to keep in mind. You won't win by trash-talking other platforms. This isn't about, you know, going to conferences and trying to tell people that Drupal's awful and it'll never work and, you know, proprietary software is evil and you should never use it. It's about focusing on what our strengths are. Not falling for the technology selection myth. So there's a great post on the CMS Move blog, which you'll find easily, which is called the CMS selection myth. And it's basically when a large enterprise is thinking about radically changing how they present content to their users, they're thinking about redesigning, they're thinking about replatforming, they almost immediately jump to what platform are we going to be on and what's the feature checklist. And they should instead be pausing and thinking about their content management strategy. What's our governance model? What are our goals and KPIs? What are our metrics? How are we going to measure ourselves? Where's our content going to come from? Who's our content strategist? What are we trying to accomplish? They need to sit back and answer all these questions first. So my advice to people is don't compete on feature checklists. If you're getting to a meeting at the point at which there's a, you know, one of those brand spreadsheets and everything's rated 1 through 5 and you've got to answer 300 questions on how effectively does your CMS do multilingual, I don't think that's a place that WordPress should be at this point. If you're having a strategic conversation with somebody early in the process about what they're trying to accomplish, and you can have a clear and positive conversation about what WordPress can do, that's the place we want to be having that conversation, right? Not as our feet fodder, but as a strategic conversation with a real stakeholder. And I didn't make a Q&A slide, so I'm ready for questions.
I have a question for you. In high tech, there's always been this sort of conflict between engineering and marketing.
I think it's on. I just touch more volume, maybe closer to the mic.
Is this better? Yeah.
That's great.
In high tech, there's always been this conflict between engineering and marketing. Now, here you're saying that it's shift. We're going to use WordPress effectively to capture the marketing. What do you see as the rate of change here? And from what I know, say, Fortune 500 companies, the way you're describing WordPress here, it's going to be a tough sell currently into a Fortune 500 company. And so this says to me that you're looking essentially in this context at a smaller company. So that's really two questions.
Sure. So I think at this point, the distinction I would make is at this point, WordPress as a full-suite content management system is a hard sell in the Fortune 500 companies. WordPress as the system to run their blog or to run their press releases site or to run some simple content site, of course, simple means different things to different people. But WordPress itself is a really easy sell. We're over the hurdle of sort of, I won't ever use open source software or that's all toys for developers, but right? We're over sort of those hurdles. The hurdle now is how do you take the blog.corporate.com platform and make it the one that actually runs www.corporate.com, right? Why do we have this sort of, we call it the WordPress ghetto. Why is it stuck as this sort of blog platform and can't break out into the larger platform? I think in terms of the challenge between business and IT, absolutely, sort of marketing IT, you know, it's cats and dogs, whatever you want to describe it as, it's the perennial conflict. What I have seen happening is a lot faster than I've seen IT people get smart about business, I'm seeing business people get smart about technology. I just think there are lots of sort of historical reasons why that's happening, but what we're seeing is a growth of a kind of marketing technologist role, or a business technologist role, a lot faster than we're seeing the sort of technical architect or the head of the IT architecture board really starting to understand the business's needs. I think historically what's happened is small departments got frustrated by the non-responsiveness of their central IT team, and they brought in an agency to build a WordPress site guerrilla style, right? Off the reservation. Don't go to your corporate IT, get somebody to just stand this microsite up on WordPress. And that's sort of how we've gotten in. But I think the reality is that strategy worked in most cases as much as IT hated it. And in fact, we're starting to now see that power come pulled back in. As we look at, so we're working with a Fortune 50 company right now on the West Coast, and the conversation that we're starting with around platform, is starting with the folks who own the content strategy and own the marketing goals, and IT is present, but it's quite clear from just the physical logistics of the meetings and the conversations that they are not involved, right? That there are attendees or anything. So one more question we have time for?
Yeah.
I don't see anyone at the mic, so I'll be hanging out. My Twitter handle has been there down at the bottom the whole time. That's the fastest way to get me. Or you can find me online. Do you want to
actually one?
Okay, very good.
Okay. Are you saying that basically give up on automatic in the sense of that they won't give you the support on the enterprise if this is up to the developers?
I'm certainly not saying give up on automatic, either in the case that they won't give you support, because I think they will, and WordPress.com VIP support is fantastic, and they'll not only help you with the project once it's underway, but they'll help you sell it. What I am saying is automatic's core businesses come from a subset of the things for which WordPress is good at. And I think automatic's marketing and heritage and growth in the products that it has pushed are at the smaller end of the spectrum, are more oriented toward volume. I think automatic's evolving, their product suite is diversifying, they're coming out with new features all the time. I just think, again, it's a question of sort of where most of their focus is, and I don't think the WordPress community writ large should rely on automatic by itself to solve these problems. I think there's enough other energy in the WordPress community that automatic can be a participant, they don't have to lead everything. Right? You sort of break that notion that automatic runs WordPress. They don't. They run WordPress.com, and they employ many of the contributors to the open source software project. But there are also a lot of contributors to WordPress.org that are outside of that, and that's healthy, and that's, from my perspective, the way it should be. You know,